There are so many questions about the timing of events and how the book of Revelation is laid out. There are four major end times views.
And in the book of Revelation,
you can go into all kinds of machinations to try to make it say what you want, but we don't really want to do that. I mean, a proper way to exegete scripture is to take a straightforward run at it and just try to understand it as best as possible. You could do a lesson on hermeneutics, and that could take several lessons, but even one good lesson would be an hour. But basically, there is symbolic language in the book of Revelation. But where that symbolic language is, most of the time it's going to be obvious. Like in nature, you don't see a great red dragon with seven heads and 10 horns. So we understand that that's symbolic. It really helps when you continue reading in the passage and it says, and here's the meaning of, and it tells you how to understand what the big red dragon is and what the heads are and what the horns are and all that kind of stuff. The other thing you could do is you can go back to Old Testament books like Daniel, and there might be similar language in there, and you can figure out how to understand it based on that. Sometimes you look for words such as like and as. His eyes were like a flame of fire. They weren't literal fire. They were like fire. I've had my mom look at me like that when I was a little kid. Her eyes were like a flame of fire. It had to do with judgment. Feet as bronze. They weren't literal bronze feet, but we understand what that means based on Old Testament passages that talk about judgment and bronze and so forth. So we want to take a look at passages in that type of a light. If you go straying away from a normal, straightforward, or what's called a literal interpretation of the Bible, then it's open to all kinds of whatever. I mean, really, you can symbolize it all away and say whatever. It means whatever you want it to mean. And, you know, who gets to decide what it means? Do I get to decide what it means? Or is it the person who has you know, the oldest person, the person of a highest rank in a church or at a university gets to decide? The one with the most degrees after their name gets to decide what the meaning is? Or maybe it's by democratic vote. Everybody gets to vote on what it means. So it's dangerous ground when you start symbolizing away scripture. Now, the of the different major schools of thought in eschatology, only the premillennial view will take a literal interpretation of the entire Bible, and in particular, the book of Revelation. And then everything else, they fall back on all kinds of figurative language or symbolic language. They have to, because what ends up happening is you want to keep your pet doctrine. So what you do is you just start looking at things in a figurative kind of a way, because that must be what it means. Well, that number can't mean that, because that messes with my theology. So I'm going to say it's symbolic for something else. So you start symbolizing it away, and next thing you know, who gets to decide? Hey, maybe the cross is symbolic, right? Maybe it's not real. Maybe the resurrection is symbolic. How about Song of Solomon? That whole thing is symbolic anyway, so maybe that's apocalyptic language and we really can't understand any of it. Any figurative language, we can't understand it. So next thing you know, you symbolize the whole Bible away, and you know, it creates a big mess. It's a big compromise. So understand that what I'm getting ready to do here is going to be from a dispensational, premillennial, pre-tribulational perspective. And if you have questions about it, please ask. Some people keep popping on to YouTube and they'll just slam down a statement and walk away. For instance, I say, there is no pre-trib. And then they walk away. And that's it. You have no exegesis. You have no Bible verse. You have no... There is no rapture. That's another one you get all the time. Another one that pops up all the time is, no man knows the day or the hour. And they just kind of walk away, figuratively speaking. Speaking of figurative, I don't know if they're really walking away or not. But they leave. They just kind of plop that statement down and walk away. That's a intellectually lazy. Examine it. Boot out the bowls. Examine it. If you have questions like,
Navy thinks it comes up, and I've tried to answer several times for people. It says,
I get a lot of responses about,
the rapture has to happen at the end.
Nothing's, we're supposed to go through all kinds of trials and temptations, and the Bible says we need to endure to the end. So it's verses kind of out of context like that, and I can demonstrate it's out of context, and I do kind of simply, I just take a straightforward, the easiest approach, and I'll say, okay, if we are not raptured until after the tribulation, you've got the sheep and the goats, judgment, and so forth, and then you go into the kingdom, the millennium. Well, if we're not raptured, and nobody's raptured until the end, and all believers are raptured at the end of the tribulation, that means everybody gets their glorified bodies, right? Where do the mortals come from that go into the millennium? The millennium, you have children described, you have sinners described, and Jesus has to rule with a rod of iron. You have, in the Old Testament, you have nations that will fall under judgment because if they don't come to Jerusalem during the high holy days, then the Lord shuts off the rain for them for a time and so forth. So this, you have after the 1,000 years, Satan has been bound for 1,000 years. After the 1,000 years, he goes out and he recruits a real quick army and goes up against Jerusalem to fight Jesus. Where does he get his army? There's no mortals. All believers have glorified bodies. You have no mortals in the kingdom at that point, because they've all been raptured at the end of the tribulation. And so now everybody's got glorified bodies, and that's who goes into the millennium. No mortals. So, see, that's just a real quick way of looking, going, okay, well, logically, exegetically, when looking at the Bible, that can't be the case. So, this is kind of the way that I try to approach Scripture, and I try to examine whether or not something is true. So I do respond to those things when people ask that. So I try to say, look, logically, we know this about the Scripture. We know this happens, and we know this happens, and we know this happens. So if you say the rapture happens at the end of the tribulation, then how do these other things in the Scripture that it describes happen? Some people will say, the kingdom is spiritual. Again, it's another one of those beliefs that spiritualizes things. The kingdom is spiritual. It's among us now spiritually, and eventually it's going to be spiritually in heaven. The kingdom is going to be in heaven. Well, we got all kinds of, a wolf laying down with a lamb, a kid playing in a viper pit that won't be bitten. We've got all kinds of other animals described too, like lions and things that aren't allowed to walk on the king's highway. And it describes Egypt. So Egypt and the other nations are up there in heaven too, because for the kingdom, it describes the nations and Egypt and so forth, and it describes them being there. So it has to be, there's no temple in heaven, as it's described in some places, but yet, so you have to get rid of the temple in Ezekiel 30 or 40 to 48. So that all takes on a symbolic meaning. The throne of Christ is all up there in heaven. There's nothing on earth. There's no earth anymore. So you got to really get creative and perform some biblical gymnastics to make a bunch of different verses work. And I'll be honest, that takes some creativity. I would rather not have to apply the Bible, because that's a road I would rather not go down. So I'd rather just take the literal view, and by literal, it just means straightforward. Literal, Jesus said, I am the door. He doesn't have a doorknob over here and then hinges over here, whatever. So he's not a literal door. We know that's symbolic language. In symbolic language becomes obvious. Context helps us determine what the meaning is. We know what Jesus means when he says, I'm the door. And he says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. So we understand these things. So anyway, if you have questions, fire away. I'm going to go through this real quick. It's going to be a real quick overview, and I might miss some things, and for that, I apologize. In fact, I definitely will miss some things. Some of it I mean to miss, and I might misstate something once in a while. I've got Egypt on my brain lately, and I keep saying Egypt when I meant Babylon. That's happened to two Bible studies lately, and it just happens that way sometimes. So grab your coffee, power drink, whatever it is you need. Sit down. You can crack your Bible open and kind of flip with me if you want, and also keep an eye on the timeline. Let me do this way. So here we are, and Book of Revelation, and I've kind of got a timeline here that I'm hoping will work properly. Here is an outline for the Book of Revelation. Okay, Revelation is apocalypsis. Now, a lot of people will say, some of these groups that like to symbolize things away, they will say the Book of Revelation and many other prophetic books or books with symbolism in them are apocalyptic literature. We can't really understand them. It's all full of symbolism and figurative language, and it's for greater minds than whoever disagrees with them to come up with the correct answers, okay? But the word apocalypse means an unveiling. It's an uncovering. It's a revealing. Revelation, the apocalypse of Jesus Christ, it's the disclosure. So it means the opposite of the way they're using it. It doesn't mean the obfuscation of Jesus Christ, the shrouding and veiling of Jesus Christ. It's the opposite of that. So we should understand Scripture in this light, that when it comes to the Book of Revelation, that the apocalypse is the unveiling, it's the revealing. So these things are being revealed to us. Now, the dating, although a minority, and it's primarily, again, I'm speaking again of like these groups, they like to date it before 70 AD. 70 AD is when Jerusalem was sacked by Nero and his ilk. excuse me. Still fighting my cold. I apologize for an occasional cough, and I hope it don't blow your eardrums out. So they'd like to move the date of the writing of the Book of Revelation before 70 AD because they like to say that Jesus, in all of that discourse, was talking about 70 AD, and the Book of Revelation symbolically is a bunch of stuff that happened in the first century. So it works out really convenient if you twist and bend things around a little bit to where it all happens before 70 AD. So it just doesn't fit, though. Irenaeus, Clement of Alexandria, Origen, Victronius, Eusebius, Jerome, they all give Domitian, Caesar at the time, Domitian as the period of writing. And he ruled from about 81 to 96 AD. Now, to further complicate things, and see, that's when John was on the Isle of Patmos where he wrote this. Now, to further complicate things, what makes it very difficult for the early dating is Jesus in Revelation chapter 2, verse 13, he names his faithful martyr Antipas. And Antipas was a believer who died in a brass bull. You've seen that horrific form of torture and execution during Domitian's reign, further setting a later date. So approximate date, most people come down about 95 AD. So Domitian, who died well after 70 AD during, not Domitian, Antipas, who died well after 70 AD, is named by Jesus in the second chapter of Revelation. So that being the case, 95 AD is probably the best date, 90 to 95, somewhere in that. In that window, the outline is in this verse that popped up here on your screen. It should have anyway. Write therefore, this is from chapter 1, I'm sorry, 119. Write therefore the things that you have seen, those things that are, and those that are to take place after this. In other words, after, meditata, after these things, the things that are the things that that are. So write about the things in the past, the things that are right now, and the future is basically what he's saying. That's the outline of the book of Revelation. And this is what he says in chapter 1. My favorite view, and I forget who first came up with this. I've heard a couple of people say it, and I like it, is when Jesus is telling John in chapter 1, write the things that you have seen. I believe it fits right in with a dating of where John could have written the Gospel of John from the Isle of Patmos. And so that would be the things that he's seen concerning Christ when he came the first time. Those things that are in chapters 2 and 3, and it's the church age. And there's a lot we could go into about that. The church age, those are all types of churches that really existed in Turkey at the time, but notice a lot of churches aren't in there. You know, Corinth is not in there. For instance, Colossae's not in there. The Church of Jerusalem's not in there. So Jesus picked out some specific churches with some warnings and some cautions and so forth and some praise for some, but not all of them. And he laid them out in the order for a particular reason. One is the order is kind of in the order that a courier carrying a letter from somebody and running from church to church to deliver a letter. That's kind of the route they would take. But also folks have remarked on how if you lay out those seven churches that are in chapters 2 and 3, if you lay them out in order, they do kind of fit the order and of the church at large, the universal church, or the most influential church, let me put it that way, most universal representation of the universal church throughout history. I'm not necessarily saying they are the true church. There's a lot of false churches. And also the main church through history, the Roman Catholic Church, was populated largely by people who were not of the universal, the body of Christ, Church of Christ. They were members of the Catholic, Roman Catholic Church. But that didn't make them. So that was the influential church at the time. We see that, for instance, in Thyatira, big time, where works is emphasized and mentioned a couple times, and very works-based type of thing. So anyway, note that and study that, and it's really remarkable how close it is. Plus, our individual churches sometimes will fit the pattern of one of those churches. You know, you got Ephesus, the church that left its first love. Is this your church? Is this a concern? Is this you individually? And Jesus offers some cautions, and we need to look in our own hearts, examine ourselves, and see if this kind of fits us. So some great, great cautions there. Now, moving forward, you flip your Bible page over to chapter 4. You see I have the 90 on here, and that is about 90 or 95 is about when the letter of Revelation was written. But I kind of fall more on like it's going to be about 95 AD. So we have John in chapter 4 and 5. And what happens to John is the term metatauta that we saw in verse 19, the things that are after these things, it kind of pops up. So now John, in his vision, or maybe he actually time traveled, maybe both is going on here, I don't know. But he finds himself in the throne room of heaven. So he says, after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me and saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place, metatauta, after this. So here's John. And he finds himself up in heaven. Now, he saw thrones, four thrones. On the thrones, I saw 24 elders clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their head. And let's get this open here. There were thunderings and lightnings, and all this stuff happened. And it speaks of the sevenfold or the seven spirits of God and so forth that happens. I'm not going to read through verse by verse in this thing. Now, the word... So immediately he finds himself up there, and then he's before the throne. And so now we're going to start looking at the whole tribulation period as it plays out in the scriptures. The word tribulation comes from the Greek word philipsis, meaning affliction and distress, and we all, on a daily basis, we do have tribulations, but Jesus speaks of a specific kind that's particularly bad in his Olivet Discourse, and he talks about great tribulation, and there's nothing that's bad up before that time or after that time. This is the worst time in all history. We also have so this is a particular type of a tribulation, a time of trouble that is unlike any time in history. You can look at Revelation 3:10, and again, I'm not going to belabor this too much here, but Jesus is saying to the faithful church, because you've kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial. What kind of hour of trial is this, John? Or Jesus? Jesus writing it, John's taking it down by dictation. It's a kind of which shall come upon the whole world. What does it do? To test those who dwell on the earth. It comes on the whole world, and it's to test those who dwell on the earth. Are the Christians here dwelling on the earth? Because he says, I'm going to keep you from that hour of trial. So how are they going to get off the earth? If it's the whole earth and it's to test those who are on the earth, somewhere or other, we've got to be off the earth. And going into the original Greek, which is, this isn't the place I'm going to do that, but it uses language that has to do with not going to be there at all, not carried through it, not having to endure it, not going to be, you know, it's the word, it's terio ek, doesn't mean that we go through like Noah on the ark. No, we're completely removed out of the way, which is what the term means. And he says, behold, I'm coming quickly, or takos, I'm coming suddenly. Behold, I'm coming suddenly, like a tachometer. So it's not like, you'll see, he said 2,000 years ago he was coming. No, it means like when I'm coming, I'm going to come like a tachometer revving. It'll be very suddenly. So trouble upon the whole earth, he says, I'm going to keep you from it, from that hour. So how do they get off? Space shuttle? You know, so that is absolutely rapture in Revelation 3:10. So it's also known in Daniel 9:24-27 as the time of Jacob's trouble or distress. It's Daniel's 70th week in Daniel 9:24-27 as well. A time of trouble or distress in Daniel 12:1. The great day, the one of their wrath, Revelation 6:17. The hour of testing, which shall try the whole earth in Revelation 3:10. The indignation in Isaiah 26:26. The tribulation and the great tribulation. Great tribulation picks up in the middle of Daniel's 70th week, 3.5 years in. Verses for that are Matthew 24:9. Matthew 24:21, also verse 29. Mark 13:19 talks about it a bit, and it's also mentioned in Revelation 7:14. The day of the Lord is mentioned 20 times in the Old Testament, 3 times in Joel alone. You can see real quick in let's see, Joel 1:15, 2:1. It's also in 1 Thessalonians 5:2, etc. It's all over the place. The day of the Lord. Day of the Lord is often associated with this time of great judgment, which God will pour upon the earth against Israel and the nations. But it's also associated with the time of millennial blessings, which follow, during which the Lord will rule on the earth. So compare Isaiah 13, verses 6 to 22, speaks of judgment. But in 14, 1 to 3, the result which comes in peace regarding Israel, we gathered in and the blessings. And you can see that in Joel 1:15 and following, and in chapter 2. And also, verses 12 to 18 in Joel 1 and 3:1 and following. 2 Peter 3, it's the day of God. And it's the day of his wrath in Zephaniah 1:18, day of the Lord's wrath. Day of darkness in Joel 2:2 and in Zephaniah 1:15. The day of the Lord in Scripture is often associated with this time, like I say. And so We see it's an extraordinary time of wrath, and we see this wrath also in Ezekiel 38, regarding Gog and Magog and those events going on. It's God's great indignation and his wrath, and he brings Gog into it. So there's a unique structure that goes on here, and we can look at it here in as it picks up in chapter 6. We've got the numbers there, chapters 4 and 5. Also, in chapter 6, we get seven seals. And notice the glowing yellow line on the left-hand side. And that's because there's kind of a break there. And this seems to be a pattern in the structure. So the Lord will give six seals, tell us what it's about, and then there'll be a break before the seventh seal. And something else will be described. A lot of times, most of the time, there'll be a parenthetical chapter as an interlude in between. And then what happens is the seventh seal hearkens to seven trumpets, which is fascinating. So the sixth seal, when that seal is broken, it brings the seven trumpets. Seven trumpets you'll see in chapters 8 and 9, but it follows a similar pattern where you've got six trumpets, and in between the sixth and seventh trumpet, there'll be another break in between, and it'll describe something and more of what's going on in some detail, but it's a little bit of a break, and it might even be a time break between the sixth and seventh seal as some events happen. And then you get to the seventh seal, and the seventh seal, trumpet, and the seventh trumpet that blows, and it heralds, it will herald the bowl judgments. And those are in chapter 16. So it's fascinating. Then you've got the seven bowls, and it's the same kind of an animal where you've got six bowls, and then there'll be a break after that, and then finally you'll read about the seventh of the bowls. Here's the pattern that we probably should be familiar with. In the middle there's war in heaven. There's the two witnesses are slain. They lay on the street within 4 days, 3.5 days actually. They are resurrected and they stand on their feet and they go up. Now, what I have written down here too, in addition to, a lot of people miss this, but in addition to the seals, trumpets, and bowls, oh my, are the woes. You have three different woes. And we can time when the woes are. We can kind of stick a pin in those and stick a pin in when the timing of the trumpets because of when the woes land and what they describe. So you have the first woe in chapter 9 and the second woe in chapter 11. And so we also have about the two witnesses. I will grant authority to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1260 days, clothed in sackcloth. Now, I've covered this before, how I believe that all is in the first half of the tribulation and the reasons why. Because the nature of the way they resurrect and what's going on the earth when they resurrect. So when they die, what you end up happening is during the Passion Week, in that vicinity, that time frame, that month of Nisan, when Christ went to the cross. So there's a lot of holy days that go on there. And they created so much trouble on the earth for the wicked, for the sinners, that when Satan is kicked out of heaven in Revelation chapter 12, Michael steps up and kicks him down, and Satan's wings are clipped, so he no longer has access to the throne. Satan has access to the throne right now because he's what? He's ever before the throne of grace, and he's accusing the saints, right? We see this in Job chapter 1 and in Job chapter 2, where Satan is up there accusing Job and accusing others. At this point, he's no longer allowed to do that, so he's kicked down to the earth, and he's angry because he knows his time's short, so he starts his scorched earth policy at that point. So what Satan does, I think one of the first things he does is he
he goes and he possesses Antichrist.
What the exact order is here, I don't know, but he possesses Antichrist at this point, and that's when we get the beast. The beast is Satan possessed Antichrist. Do we have precedence for this? We do. For one thing, is Judah. Judas was possessed by Satan, right? And Jesus leans over to him and says, what you must do, do quickly. You know, in other words, go be about your business and go do it. This is at the Last Supper, right? So sometimes this happens, and this happens here. So this is where we get the beast. Satan comes down, possesses Antichrist. Another thing that happens is Satan, the great dragon, who is now in Antichrist, goes after the two witnesses and slays them. And then they lay in the streets for 3.5 days. And while they're laying in the streets for 3.5 days, everybody's partying. They're exchanging gifts. They make a holiday out of it. And their bodies are laying there in the streets. And finally, after 3.5 days, the whole world is watching as they pop up on their feet because the Lord breathes life into them. And then the whole world is watching and they ascend into heaven. So now let's contrast this with the end of the book of Revelation. By the end of the book of Revelation, just some highlights of some things that are going on. We had a big CME pop off and it scorched a bunch of men. And the earth is black. Everything is burnt. All kinds of bad things happen. You got a chunk of the corona from the sun hits the earth, and it's going to be bad news. And it's going to create a lot of damage. We've got, whereas we've had in the seals, you had a great earthquake there where all the islands have been shaken and all the mountains have been shaken. And it, one quarter of the world is destroyed. That comes out to about 2 billion people. And then by the time you get into the middle up here, you get into the trumpets, you had one quarter of the earth destroyed in the seals. You got one third of the world destroyed in the trumpets. If you start off with 8 billion, assuming that it happens very soon, you have a population of 8 billion. If one quarter is destroyed, that means 2 billion people die. So that leaves 6 billion people alive on the earth, roughly. If one third of that 6 is destroyed, that's another 2 billion. So that means half the world is wiped out just in the seals and trumpets alone. So then we get into, later on, we're going to get into the bowls. We're fixing to show that. But how much the world is wiped down in the bowls? You've had massive hail, man-sized hail that's fallen to the earth. You had in the trumpets, you had a third of the water of the earth turned to blood. But by the time you get to the end of the bowls, the end of the timeline on the right, you've had all the water turned to blood. You've had all these great earthquakes happen to where now all of the islands have sunk. Bye-bye, Hawaii. And then you've had all the mountains have been leveled. Let's say goodbye to all your ski lifts. So that's some pretty serious quake activity. Plus all the disease that's been going on and things. People are pretty wiped out. Armageddon is going on, literally. Now you've got all the armies of the earth all gathered in the Valley of Megiddo. So you've got Armageddon going on. That's not exactly a party atmosphere where people are going to be exchanging presents. And I don't know about satellite activity and cell phone activity at that time working, where everybody in the whole world will be able to watch the two witnesses rise to their feet and ascend into heaven. And so if you've got them going on for 1,260 days anyway, and they start in the middle of the tribulation, then that puts them at ascending up into heaven after Jesus has already come back. And they might, they're going to kind of pass us as we return with Christ on the way down, they're ascending up. That doesn't. So now that really quite makes sense. So it makes a lot more sense. Two witnesses at the beginning, and that's possibly through their conversion activities and whatever else, and through their leadership, they're leading the 144,000, 12,000 from each of the tribes of Israel. So it makes sense that all that great evangelism and things like this and judgment pronouncement upon the Antichrist and the Babylonian system and all the things that are going on. It makes much more sense that that all is going on in Jerusalem from the start all the way to the middle. And again, Satan possesses Antichrist in the middle. So chapter 11 is what you see is activities that should land right in the middle of the book. So chapter 9, what's going on is that this is around, it says in the 9:1, it says, and the fifth angel blew his trumpet. So there you got the fifth angel in chapter 9, right? Then the description is followed by the first woe in verse 12, right, in 9:12. The first woe has passed. Behold, two woes are still to come. So we know that the first woe, as we have it right in here, is right about where it should be. Right about where it should be. Let's see. Chapter 10 says the angel and the scroll vision. So we can see that's kind of a parenthetical chapter. Chapter 11 is about the two witnesses. So the two witnesses we just discussed. And then what it does is it says they are referenced here in the mid-trib in the past tense as though this is completed by the time we get to the second woe. So what ends up happening is the second woe, flipping the Bible real quick, let's see, so you've got, let's take a look. In the seventh chapter, you've got the 144,000. And so one thing that happens in the middle of the seventh chapter is you've got verse 9, and it talks about a great multitude no one can number from many tribes and nations, people, they're sitting before the throne of God in white robes. And this is where we see the martyrs and things before the throne of God. Now, why do we see these people here before the throne? It's weird because it's in the same chapter as 144,000. Well, I personally believe that all this happening, by the time you get to the middle of the tribulation, these are the converts and now martyrs, the converts of the 144,000. So you've got, in chapter 7, you've got the sealed 144,000 and their converts, who are now most of them, or many of them, that nobody can number before the throne of God. These are the martyrs. Okay, and then in chapter 8, you've got the seventh seal. And the seventh seal, as I said, is the prelude to the seven trumpets. So, you know, you got vegetation struck in verse 7. Second angel sounds something like a great mountain burning fire falls into the sea. So you've got all these trumpets happening. And then finally, you got the fifth trumpet coincidental with chapter 9. And you got the sixth trumpet in the middle of chapter 9. And it's the angel from the Euphrates, and you've got all these bad demonic creatures coming out, falling out of Euphrates, and looking to sting people and so forth, like a scorpion. So it's going to be really bad. Then you've got a parenthetical book in chapter 10. And it's like John knew your break, and God decided to give him a break because he's told to eat the little book. I think the little book and the scroll that he eats, I think it's the same one that we had in chapter 6. It's bittersweet. He's teaching John about how the little book is bittersweet. It's great because it's a revelation of Jesus Christ, and he's taking back creation, but at the same time, it's bitter in your belly because of all the horrors that are coming down and all the deaths and so forth. So it's a bittersweet kind of a thing. And then you have the two witnesses in chapter 11 and so forth. And then we've got, let's see here. Got going on here. Make sure I didn't miss something. We're here. And then we have chapter 12, where the remaining time is 1260 days. 12:6, it says the woman fled into the wilderness, the woman being Israel, where she has a place prepared by God, where she's nursed for 1260 days. And this is the same imagery as was given to Joseph about the woman and the 12 tribes and so forth. It fits that imagery perfectly. And then, let's see here. So, we've got chapter 12. We have war in heaven that's been going on, right? And Satan's kicked to the earth. And then you have the abomination of desolation, which happens. And that picks up Really, we understand more of that when we get into chapter 13 and 14, where the beast, the Antichrist, goes into the temple. He stops the sacrifices and sets up an image of the beast to be worshipped. He stands in the middle of the temple, 2 Thessalonians 2, and declares himself God. And we have the woman fleeing into the wilderness to Petra up in the mountains. This is all the events that kick off the Great Tribulation. And the Great Tribulation we know is also known as, here's another way of looking at it, it's the second half, it's 42 months. Or she's over there for, Israel is up there hiding for a time, times and half a time. Is all Israel there? No, in Zechariah we read that, if I've got this right, it's something like half of Jerusalem is saved as a remnant, and they go off, but then one third of Israel as a whole goes and flees. So there's some people who choose to stay behind. So God always has his remnant, not everybody's saved. And there are many times of judgment in the Old Testament with Israel, particularly in the wilderness, where we see the ground opened up and swallowed people, what have you. So, but God always has his remnant that he carries through. So what I'm showing here is that is an overall timeline in the year. It starts, you know, like toward the end of the first year, it would be the rapture. And we're looking at chapter 13 now, which is chapter 13 to 14 is where we see the beast system set up and the number of the beast. Now, something about the number of the beast, there is no beast system right now. Nobody coming at you to give you a poke in the arm or insert a chip into you or put a tattoo on you or nanites in your blood or anything like that. Those might all be precursors, might be the way that the beast system will end up working eventually, but you got to have a beast before you can have a beast system. Part of that, none of that is going to send you to hell. What sends you to hell is worshiping to get that stuff, because, you know, your life is more important to you than the Lord, and so you're going to bow down and worship, and you're going to worship the beast. That's what's going to send people to hell. It's not so much the nature of the mark, the jab, the, you know, whatever it is that's going on and how that plays out. You've got to worship to get it, and that's what does it. And then you're doomed at that point. So then, as I'm flipping through my Bible here, so we've got in chapter 14, it talks about, you know, the gathering of the nations and so forth. And things are starting to set up, and things are shifting and moving as they must by this time. It took a lot of energy, money, and effort to move armies all over the place. So armies are going to start gathering and moving toward Armageddon, because Satan's getting ready to do all this stuff, right? So we got the prelude to the bowl judgments in chapter 15. And it describes a tabernacle in a different group of people than we've seen elsewhere. Then in chapter 16, you've got the bowl judgments. Chapter 16 is the bowl judgments. And, you know, you've got wind scorched, like I said, darkness and pain. Euphrates is dried up. The earth is utterly shaken at this point. In chapter 17 and 18, you've got both legs of the beast, the Babylonian system, being destroyed by Antichrist. One is the governmental monetary system of the earth, the world system being destroyed. But you've also got the mystery Babylon being destroyed, which is the religious system, and all that sets up for chapter 19, where the announcements of Christ coming, and we hear John's down on earth and he's hearing this proclamation from the heavens. He's down on earth and he's hearing this from up over his head, saying, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb, because they know it's close. Jesus comes, he comes on the white horse in chapter 19, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And then we've got him, as we see in passages in the Old Testament, where he is wiping out the Antichrist's armies. He's gathering and rescuing his saints that are in Petra. There's the Valley of Decision or the sheep and the goats at that point, where you've got the goats cast into outer darkness, and then you've got the lambs on the on his right. And these are all survivors, mortals, of the tribulation at this point. Then you've got the marriage supper of the Lamb, and that's another thing that this happens that's different than the way some people understand it. They're thinking the marriage supper of the Lamb happens as soon as you're raptured and you go to heaven. No, not quite. That's 7 years of celebration. In the Hebrew wedding tradition, it's a week-long celebration, 7 days. And they're celebrating. At the end of the week, the doors of the Father's house are thrown open, and the guests are invited. And at that time, there's an announcement. She might often be veiled again, just for the fun of it. And so the announcement is made, "Behold the bride, now wife of the Lamb." And they take off the veil. Everybody's excited and shouting and so forth. And that's when the public marriage supper happens. And the guests are all brought in and stuff. And so the tables are all set up outside in the courtyard, what have you. And you have this big public marriage supper. So that's the marriage supper of the Lamb. So all the Old Testament saints are going to be there. All the saints who are martyred to get their glorified bodies. So those are the forms of the resurrection that happened there. And then, of course, the church, the bride of Christ, is there, of course, because she's the bride. She's not one of the guests. She's the bride. And that's us. So we in Christ, and it's our marriage supper. It's at the end. So we're there. The doors are opened up, and the guests come in. Now, I want to point out that the events that happen in chapter 20 are coincidental. They go along with, in concert with, chapter 21. A lot of people on timelines don't put this together this way, but this is restoration. The world's got to be restored, as it must, because it's trashed. So we're not going to have kingdom. We're not going to have paradise on earth. We're not going to have the millennium if everything's still bloody and sooty and poisoned and whatever else. So we have Jesus making all things new. So in chapter 20, it describes the people, the characters, Satan and his ilk, and what happens to those in judgment and God's people going forward into the millennium. What happens even from the tribulation and going into the millennium, and this is a big who's who. So chapter 20 is the big who's who. Chapter 21 picks up the narrative from where chapter 19 left off. And Jesus is making all things new. And there's a number of reasons why we see that chapter 21 is picking up the narrative. For one thing, is we've got John in there in heaven, and he's talking to an angel who still has a bowl in his hands. That wouldn't be 1,000 years later. And he's pointing out the holy city, New Jerusalem, which is our home, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So we live in that. Why would we still be up there in heaven? No, we come down with Christ at the end of the tribulation. So this is all about us. The narrative, again, picks up. And remember, we also have described inside of New Jerusalem, in chapter 21, this great tree that's got some leaves in it on the tree that are for the healing of the nations. Well, if that all is after the new heaven and new earth, which is supposed to be at the end of the millennium in some timelines, who needs healed? Everybody's perfect. New heaven, new earth. Why do we need healing? No, so the New Jerusalem is hovering slightly over the earth. It's our home during the millennium. You've got New Jerusalem and Old Jerusalem there. The church, the bride, now wife of Christ, is dwelling in there. Christ has a throne there. Christ has a throne in the temple. Christ has a throne in Jerusalem. Christ has a throne wherever he decides to sit. That's his throne. Remember, chapter 20 talks about the great white throne judgment, right? So if that's been back in chapter 20, why would you have Jesus talking about in chapter 22 about the holy city, outside are dogs and sorcerers and sexually immoral and murderers and idolaters and whoever loves and practices a lie? Well, wait, they're all gone. If we believe that this is all stuff that he's describing that takes place after the great white throne judgment in chapter 20, see, so this just demonstrates that chapter 21 and going into chapter 22 a bit are all about New Jerusalem
We come back. That's all part of the new heaven and new earth, the restoration that begins chapter 20 and chapter 21. Great White Throne Judgment happens at the end of all of that. And frankly, we don't know a lot about what happens after the Great White Throne Judgment into eternity's future. Eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, nor has it even entered into the heart of man, you know, or into man's imagination, what God has in store for those who love him. So we don't know what goes on in eternity's future, but it's got to be wonderful. So here I've kind of listed what's parenthetic. Here's another way of looking at this again. As you can see, on the left-hand side, we have chapter 1, and that's where Jesus comes to John and starts talking to him about what's going to be happening here. And then chapter 2 and 3, the things that are. And so that's the churches. Chapter 4 and 5, is he's in the before the throne room of God in those chapters. And then chapter 6 starts the seals. So you can see that scroll there, the title deed of heaven and earth. And it's going to end up being opened like so. So it's the Lamb of God who opens the seals. So we know wrath starts right away. It's called wrath by the time you get to the end of the chapter. And, you know, you get a few verses into it, and you've already got 2 billion people dead, being killed by animals and all kinds of means and famine. So, and it's all described as the wrath of the Lamb. And it's the Lamb who's opening the seals and doing this. He is the one who is doing this. So, again, chapter 7 is a parenthetic, as I say. And then we have this parenthetic right here that points to chapter 7. And we have chapter 8, which is the prelude going up to opening of, or the sounding of the trumpet judgments. And you can see those, trumpet 1, trumpet 2, the third trumpet, fourth trumpet, and it's the fifth trumpet. And without going into and reading what all these are, you got a woe coming in here, and that's in chapter 9. And then you've got the six trumpets preparing to sound the seventh trumpet, which will kick off the bowls. But before then, you got another parenthetical chapter, again, chapter 10, as I described. And here's this parenthetic that happens, chapter 10. And then chapter 11 is going to be about the two witnesses. See 11a on the far left-hand side of your screen there. That's about the two witnesses. Okay, and then you've got 11b, and the another woe kicks off right here about this time. Chapter 12, you know, Satan kicked out of heaven and so forth. 13, 14, we got the beast system going on with Antichrist and the false prophet and so forth. All that great tribulation stuff is happening. And then the seventh trumpet sounds. So you've got all this preparation going to happen for, you know, and the Euphrates drying up and the armies gathering and so forth, getting ready for Armageddon and all that kind of stuff that happens. Some bad news. And so we got a woe up there. Chapter 12 is the third woe, as we read. And then 16, you can see the bowls dumping over down at the bottom. Chapter 16 are the seven bowls. And then there's the fourth bowl. And the fifth bowl. I know I'm a geek for making this, huh? But I wanted it to be animated and interesting to look at least. Then you've got you've got Armageddon that actually starts kicking off right there in between chapters or bowls 6 and 7 is actual Armageddon. You got the seventh bowl by the time you get to 18. So that's all answers, gets into the second half of what we're looking at in 14a and then the third part of chapter 14. You might want to take a look at those. And let's see here. We've got also these chapters here. Notice that chapter 17 is a parenthetic, and it
is about events that are a little bit earlier. But chapter 19 is the second coming. And notice I have 20 equals 21 because that they both, those are both millennial chapters. One describes all the people and players and where they are. Chapter 21 describes the events. I believe they're both talking about the kingdom era. One is about all the players, all the people, the different parties involved, characters, however you want to put that. Chapter 21 is the events. Chapter 22, A, is going to be getting into about, it goes into, well, a bunch of stuff about New Jerusalem and so forth, and we have more of that in chapter 22. But chapter, the second half of chapter 22, though, is really Jesus signing off and giving his final last words, his last comments to the book. So that is as quick an overview as I can give of the book with a couple different timelines, a couple of three different ways of looking at it. And I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope it clarifies things for you. They, again, some people, like I said, some people will try to say the seals and the trumpets and the bowls all happen at the same time, and they're all just a restatement of one another, and they all happen in one big clump. And they can't, like I say, because you've got different quantities of things that are described in each one. In the seals, it's one fourth of things. But like birth pangs, they start off smaller and they build with intensity. And we've heard birth pangs used a number of times when it comes to descriptions of the end times. So this is, again, is the same kind of thing with birth pangs. So you've got the seal judgments, which are in quarters. A quarter of the earth is this, and a quarter of this is that, and whatever else goes on. Then you get to the trumpets, and those are in thirds. It doesn't really give the quantities in the bowls. Maybe it's halves of what's left, which seems reasonable to me, because you're going from quarters to thirds and probably halves with the bowls. So you really have a small remnant left by the time you get to the end of the book. And that's why the days shorten. Because if the Lord had not stepped down in chapter 19, then, and so those days are shortened by his return, then no flesh would be saved. Because you could see the trajectory of where it's going. We've got Armageddon going on here. Already more than half the world is wiped out. And everything's burning and there's no water to drink. So if Jesus didn't come back when he did, no flesh would be saved. So that's how those days are shortened. No, the days aren't compressing and going from 24-hour days to 20 or 15-hour days or 10-hour days or whatever. There's no precedence for that at all. Those days are shortened by Christ's return. He steps down in the nick of time to save the remnant that's left. I have realized that was a lot in a short, condensed space, but I hope the overview helps you as you're being like the Brian and you're reading and you're testing the things I say and that everybody else says, and examining those things. If you have questions, feel free to comment, and I'll try to get to them. I try to read them, but you know that the numbers are growing as far as people looking at these things. One of the ways I might respond, especially if a lot of the questions and comments are similar, is follow up with more videos, and I might do a Q&A video. I might even do a Q&A. I've mentioned this before. I might even do a live Q&A type of video where, your comments are scrolling on the side, and maybe I can read some of them, and maybe I can go and try to answer them as I go, but I'm not sure. That might be inviting insanity there, because they can scroll so quickly with the number of people slapping down comments and sometimes rude comments as we go. I don't know, but ain't nobody got time for that. I know I probably don't. It's probably asking for trouble. So anyway, I hope you're blessed by this, and I hope you're blessed by spending time in the Word. All the videos and things that are out there, awesome, great. Spend time in researching and watching videos and so forth, reading books, but mostly read the Bible. Put your nose in the Bible and study that, and look at it with a critical lens, what other people are teaching, what I'm teaching, and compare it with Scripture and see how it stands up. Don't believe everything you hear. Don't believe all the dreams and visions and things that people are claiming that. Some people come up with some funny math, and some people are coming up with some funny words and ways of adding things. Don't Don't try to add numbers and bring numbers in and bring numbers in from like the Strong's exhaustive concordance. Like Strong was a good man. He invented a great system for tracking the Greek and Hebrew words and putting in almost like a dictionary type of a format, cataloged numerically so we could find them easily and cross-reference them. But it's not inspired. The verse breaks and chapter breaks in your Bible are not inspired. These are all man-made things as to make it helpful, they hoped or thought, to make it helpful in reading the Bible and in comprehending the Bible and being able to find things. They put verses in so that you could cross-reference and things. But these are all man-made. The Strong's exhaustive concordance, you don't go and take some math and go, ooh, this word is this, and hey, that Strong's number is this. And if you take this Strong's number, which is, 432, and you add it together with this, it comes out to this, and it's this year. You can't do that. It's not a proper way to exegete. Look at context, 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 context. That tells you whether you should or can use a particular number you're reading in the Bible or not. Just try to be real, and don't stretch things and try to shoehorn things together to make them fit. You're just going to end up off the mark and lost. You want to rightly divide the word of truth. And that's the best way to do it. Preach the gospel out there. Jesus Christ, 2,000 years ago, lived the perfect life that we could not live. His righteousness is imputed to those who believe. Faith is granted to those who he calls. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So whereas we're dead in trespassing sins, his Holy Spirit quickens us and helps us to see the light. The Father calls us. The Father draws us to the Son. Jesus says, I'll not lose one of my sheep who the Father has given me. He won't lose even one. Pray for those who are lost. Share the gospel. He died on the cross for our sins, paid for our sins. His righteousness is imputed unto us. Any wrath that we should go through as believers has already been taken care of on the cross. Jesus took the wrath of God on the cross. And 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And because he rose physically from the dead, someday we will too. And so get out there and share the word with people, pray for people, and keep looking up. When you see the beginning of these things happening, we are told, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. And it is near. And scriptures, I believe, indicates and drops enough hints that shows that it's near. And also, you could just sense it. You could just feel it too. Feelings are very subjective, but so take it to the scripture and verify all things. God bless.